Okay, let's begin. Growth devices, why and how? A little disclaimer before we begin. Basically an introduction talk, so if someone has been using some graphic devices, he might be bald. Okay, let's begin. Let me introduce myself. I'm the Chief Software Architect at IT Imagination. It's a big Polish IT company. I'm also the architect of a big IT system, Spotify developers, and so on and so on. But about half of it, I'm also interested in distributed systems and basically digging data. And digging data part led me to graph databases. And I'm also running a pet project called Cookit, and we will get back to it at the end of the presentation. Okay, graphs. Basically, this is the best part because I can start our presentation with a sentence. Long, long time ago, there was a king, and the king had a reward. And this actually will be true. This happened in Kaliningrad, in current Russia. Basically, in 1736, Kaliningrad had, as you can see, many rivers, and as you can see, many bridges. And the king actually, as the legend goes, said that he will give a reward for someone who will say, if I can cross every bridge one time and cross them all. Then stepped Mr. Knight on a shiny horse and so on, but he was a mathematician, so it was Leonhard Euler, mapped it to something like this, then to something like this, and said, no, actually you can't, because the only way you could if every node had a number of edges that would be dividable by two. Okay, the legend goes here, but we should go to the map description. So the map description goes like this. Graph is a pair of edges and of nodes and edges between those nodes. And it's quite important. Okay. So what are basically graphs? Let's have a basic understanding. This is a graph, a very sad one, but still a graph. Let's make it more interesting. So let's add him a friend. So we have a node, and an edge. As simple as this graph is, it's basically Facebook. I know you know me, so yeah, basically. Next, let's make things a bit more interesting. So I know you, but you don't know me. And this is Twitter. Oh, in real life stalking, so don't do it in real life. And next, we can add values to these edges, and this is the basic interpretation, basic idea when people think about graphs. Because we have city and the directional road between those two cities. Of course, the number represents the length of the road. Sorry. Next, we can go a bit funky, and we can create something that is called a multi-node graph. Basically, this is a graph that allows two nodes to have multiple edges of the same type. As funky as it is, it has some usages in math, but actually it's not often implemented because in most cases you can simulate this graph using this one. Okay, let's go a bit down to earth. We can have something that is called labeled graph. So labeled graph is a graph that has labels on nodes and on edges. It's cool, but this is way cooler because this is called a property graph. And this is the graph that we will most likely see in most implementations in current databases. So what this allows us is basically to have any data connected to the edge and the node. And also we can have labels. Now, a bit of a contest. Does this remind anyone of something? And if I do this, and if I do this, come on, aren't there any enterprise architects in here? Basically, this looks like a schema of a relational database. So here I am talking about graphs, and I'm talking about relational databases. So relational databases have relations; it's in their name. So graphs have relations. So why do we actually are talking about graph databases? Basically, the question is what will I be doing for the last 40 minutes? To understand basically this, why those two are completely different, let's take a look at the, some history. Okay, relational databases came to life as a, piece of paper. In 1917, Mr. Edgar Codd wrote a paper that wrote a paper describing how he could how he sees the relational model. To understand basically what else happened, why this paper had such a success, and why are still we still using this those databases, let's see what else happened in the 70s. Basically, RAM got quite cheap because 2 years earlier we would be paying more than $2,500 for 1 megabyte. And as I see from the audience, this is for the young ones. Yeah. So it's not much. Next, IBM offered this, and it has 100 megabytes of storage. And if someone is thinking about thinking that it looks like a dishwasher, it's the size. It is the size of a dishwasher. Here we have the monitor, and this is our storage. And also one funny thing is that basically when they wrote the specs for it, they were precise to the byte how fast it is. It's 1,0034 megabytes a second. Yeah. So as you can imagine, also the access time were quite similar as a dishwasher. Let's go further. And in 91, we can play Mario because we have 8 bits. And we have a bit over 700 kilohertz. And again, yeah, 100,000 kilohertz, 1 megahertz, and the megahertz I will explain later. And next, 3 years later, we have a bit more kilohertz, but we have 16 bits, and that's all. Next, 3 years later, Oracle actually implements the paper and creates the first commercial relational database. And of course, we have Apple, the first non-white model. And next, Intel releases something that later becomes the milestone of computing, and that is the grandfather of almost every chip that you have in your laptops, the 8086. And we have a whopping 10 megahertz. And as I promised, yeah, 1,000 megahertz, 1 gigahertz for the young ones. Okay, now let's look how did the history of graph databases look like. As I said, we begin with the king, which have a problem, and of course the bridge problem. Next, we have the graph coloring problem. This problem is a problem that's quite strongly correlated with the history of computing, and we will get back to you. Next, if we are talking about math, we should have a book. So in 1936, we have the book Graph Theory, and now we can start talking about graphs in math. Next, in 1969, the problem of graph coloring, of map coloring, is partly solved. Why partly? Because basically the scientists, mathematicians, have a proof, but there is a big bug, because in the paper, they say that there is a group of 40,000 graphs that should be manually checked if they can be colored in using four colors. Because we are lazy and we don't have enough crayons, we had to wait 30 years for it. And I think from what I remember, 7 days of computing to actually prove that yes, this and any political map, any map can be colored using four colors. Next, Pentium 4 with almost 4 gigahertz comes up. And does anybody remember which part of the computer had a huge revolution thanks to Pentium 4? Okay, so this is the cooler for Pentium 3, and this is the cooler for Pentium 4. And this looks like a jet engine with not without a reason, because Pentium 4 had huge cooling problems. basically they were so big that Intel actually scraped the idea, went back to Pentium 3, took those two chips, put them in one chip, and thanks to this we had core duo and the multi-core revolution. Next, 2003, first commercial graphic devices. So why am I actually talking about the history? Because if you look at it, relational databases came into being when we had huge increase in computing power, RAM, bits, and almost everything. While graph databases came after the crash of the Pentium. We now knew that we actually can't keep on going on one call, and we actually have to go parallel. Next thing is that basically if you think about the relational model, the first thing that should come to your mind is the other relational forms. And if you think a bit about why do we actually have them? One, of course, for the reporting. And the second part is basically if you replace a string with an int or a short int and something, if you replace a date and so on and so on, you will actually save the disk space. This and the space that the data is actually using. So the relational model came to be because we actually had so slow drives that we had to minimize the space that it actually took in the price of the computing power. Okay, I talked about history, now let's see the current landscape of graphic databases. Sorry about that. Okay, we have two scales, processing, the natives in the top, and storage also, native in the right. And I will explain actually what I mean by that. In the lower left corner, flop. Flop is sometimes very often called the graph database of the poor. Why? Because actually flop can only get the direct child of the node. So why would you build a graph database that can actually only take the children? It's quite easy when you understand who actually built Flock. Flock was built by Twitter. And if you think about how Twitter works, when you tweet something, Twitter's actually only interested in one thing: getting the person who are observing you and putting this tweet on their feed. That's all. And this pattern actually describes very well that graph databases are built to solve one specific problem. And if you are using them for this specific problem, everything will go very, very good. If not, they can actually hurt your system and yeah, it will hurt. Okay, let's go further. Processing. Basically, this line means if you are asking your data, if you are processing the data in a graph way. We will see on the examples. Basically, on the top left, we have Microsoft Trinity. Then it was called Microsoft Graph Project. And I used to talk that basically it's a very interesting graph database. It was built for computing very large distributed graph databases, of course in Azure. Basically what they did is quite interesting, because they had a thought that when you have a huge graph database, you actually don't know on which node you will have the data. So all the processing in this database is done using messages. So if you want something, you send the messages, and the database actually routes these messages to the separate node. And what is actually even better in this database, that Microsoft actually open sourced it, I think, 3 or 4 days ago. So we can actually see what's in it. Yeah. Next, Infinite Graph. Infinite Graph is also a quite interesting beast, because what you get is a graph that is distributed, that storage is distributed. So basically what you have is that the processing engine is local, but the storage is split between many geographical locations. Next, Titan. We'll get back in Titan. Titan is currently we can say that it was replaced by Julius. But Tekken has an interesting way because Tekken has a replaceable storage and processing engine. So you can swap, you can use Cassandra, you can use Solar, Elastic, and Hadoop. Next. And let's go here. So basically, moving in the right, we are moving into native storage. What this means is that here, basically, we have a graph API. So we are asking in a graphy way about data. Here, we are storing the data in the way that is suitable for graphs. So see, here we have OrientDB, and OrientDB is quite interesting piece because this is a graph database that has relational capabilities, key value store, and graph capabilities, all using SQL. So yeah, if you can't make a decision, Orient is the way to go. Next, affinity index. One is basically a database used for phones. If you have a graph of problem that should be solved in a phone, yeah, use it. The other is built for very low latency. And on the top right corner, we have Neo4j. And we'll get back to it, so I won't waste time. Next, Allegro Graph and HyperDB. Those two graph databases are built for one purpose, basically storing knowledge and processing knowledge. So processing very huge, like tens and hundreds of terabytes of data of knowledge. What you do is basically dump geological, physical, chemistry data, and from the radiations you get some interesting stuff. Okay, let's go to usage. Okay, first suggestions. If you actually go to Amazon, you will see that they are not showing you here similar books. They actually are showing you something that they are calling frequently both together. So Amazon is saying that yeah, we are not interested in showing you books that are similar in any way. We are interested in showing you books that you can actually buy. So basically calculating similarity using humans. So what they actually do is something like this. Let's take one person, he enters Amazon, clicks a bit, and buys something. Simple. Let's take another person, he enters here, clicks, buys something. Simple. And another one. Enter, clicks. Buy something. As you can see, probably. When you look at this data in a relational manner, actually some things start to light up. Basically some edges start to get bigger because they are used more. Some nodes, like this node, people are looking at it, but in the end, buy this one. So this is a reinforcement that if anyone goes into this node, we should show this node. Yeah, this is how Amazon actually can calculate which books to show. Of course, if the load on the website is small, it doesn't make any sense. But if you are talking about thousands and millions of visits, yeah, it actually makes sense. Next, money laundering. Basically, what you do if you have €1 million, you can actually go and buy a Porsche, buy a new house, but then the German IRS will come to your home and ask one simple question. Could you actually show us where did you get the money for this beautiful car and so on? And if you didn't answer, then you will go to jail. So, how do you actually make this money legal? There are many ways, but this is one of the simplest. Basically, you get a lot of friends. What is funny, I got this slide from my friend who is actually looking for people who are money laundering for a bank. So yeah, but don't get it as an instruction. So you get a lot of friends, you give them cash. They go to a hairdresser, spa, salon, and so on. it has to be a place that it's very hard to prove how many customers you had and how much money you spent on a single customer. So they spend this money, then this person so-and-so goes to another shop, and this money flows, and in the end, after taxes, of course, it goes back to your pocket. So how do you actually find these cases? It's quite easy. It was done done also recently in the Panama Papers leak. You actually input each invoice, from who to whom, and the amount. The amount is just in the cash flow. And if you input a large number of those transactions, you will actually see some routes. But some people are doing business more often than another, and if you see those routes, you can basically tap them, start observing them, and finally you will see something like this. This is Iceland. Probably all of people of Iceland. But basically, this happened when some people got the Panama Papers dump. The dump weighed on more than 10 terabytes, and they actually started inputting those data into Neo4j. It was totally objective data, from who to whom the amount, and thanks to inputting data and then seeing the transfer and who is connected, they could ask the Iceland's prime minister, why do you have accounts in foreign countries? And those in the morning, the prime minister saw this, basically people wanting him to remove. Yeah, so graphs are powerful. NLP, basically, I don't know if someone is doing NLP, sorry for that, this is a way of a simplification, but it points my case. Yeah, happens. Okay, let's say we have a huge social portal, and we have a search box. And someone inputs sushi restaurants in New York that my friends like. Well, this sentence is quite easy to understand on the level of tokens. Sushi, yeah, we can get it. Type of food. Restaurants, type of place. New York, also type of place, but a geographical one. That my friends like, we have me as a starting point, and my friends. Simple. But actually, how to go from understanding the single tokens to the answer? Well, it's quite easy. So, what did I miss? Let's take me. This is not me because I don't have that many friends. Happens. stock photos, yeah. Okay, so I took my friends. Quite easy operation. Basically, I took a single node and the children of this node. Then I took New York. Again, from all the nodes of type location, single node. Then I took the cuisine sushi. Again, from all the nodes of this type, sushi. I think it's a very, very, very simple operation. So what is actually the answer to my question? We have this part, we have this part, and we have this part. So the nodes connected to all of them will be the answer to my question. It is a way of simplification, but it also is a way of answering to this question. And what's even more awesome in this example is, if you look at this, you will see that even if I have billions of nodes, in each step, I was talking about single or very little numbers of nodes. So if we have a graph that has billions and billions of nodes, I'm not operating on billions of nodes. A couple of hundred, a couple of thousand, max. So this shows that if you have a graph database and you use it with curve and with fault, you can actually have huge data sets and process them in milliseconds. Next. This is also a real example. It's a example of New York Times. New York Times has this, now they have many problems, but they had a problem 1 year ago that basically they when they are writing articles, they journalists have to know specific data about some objects. So let's take an apple, a symbol, yeah. Apple is also, of course, the thing, of course, the fruit. So with this apple, we have nutritional values, firms that are selling apples, the stock price, and so on, so on, so on. Next, we have Apple Inc. With Apple Inc, we have connected employees, Tim Cook, the iPhone, and so on, so on, so on. Next, we have films. Actually, there are two films named Apple. We have one Star Trek episode, because there is a Star Trek episode for everything. We have Apple Records, which, of course, is the Beatles recording company, which is connected to the Apple Inc. We have one Russian party that is nicknamed Apple. And if you go to the Wikipedia page, you will see actually, I think, 17 versions of the word Apple. So what they used Neo4j and GraphQL is basically, if you treat each of them as a single node, and just in a graph way, look at those nodes in specific context, you can actually connect all this data, and basically by having separate views on this data, you can actually have all of this in one database. To actually prove it, you don't actually have to work in New York time, because we have this Google Knowledge Graph. We have this, it's I think 10 years old. Now, what's interesting, because we have Mr. Euler, because we are talking about graphs, so we have to have Mr. Euler. We have born, died, education, spouses, so normal fields, and influence. So in this field we have as links, written people that he influenced by. So this, in a way, isn't a field that you would put if you were modeling it using an object database or a relation database, because it's not common. But some might argue that, well, this is for famous people, and famous people influence each other, and so on, so on. Yeah, but we have Spock, and Spock has a field called species. And it's, of course, the value is Vulcan, which is a link. So if you are thinking in a graph way, adding data doesn't actually change anything. It doesn't make anything more complicated. It's just small data that you can traverse. The data actually shapes the structure of your database. Okay, let's go further. Performance. This is the model of a relational database, and this is the graph database. So, did anyone actually model a relational or a hierarchical structure using a SQL Server or Oracle or any graph or any relational databases? Yeah. So those people know my pain. So basically, if we have a case like this, what we are doing? Like taking one node, so basically you have a table, let's call them person, and a table called person children. So we take one node, get the children of this node, and in this case, and when we want to get next children, what we're actually doing is taking 10 nodes and joining it with table that has probably a couple of million nodes, and again and again and again. So you get the idea where the performance bottleneck will be. So you are joining each time with a huge table. Of course, it has an index, but more or less, it's huge. Well, in the graph version, we have the node, and this node actually has the data about its children right at it. So we don't have to traverse it. We don't have to go to another table and so on and so on. We just have the data taking the node. So this is what I was talking when I was talking about storing data in a graph way. Okay, next, traversing, because the way that you actually store data influences what you can do with it. Let's say you want to find an edge between this point and this one point. What do you do? I take the children. Next, I go to separate graphs. And what I can actually do, even if those graphs are in some way connected, I can actually process them individually. There are many ways and many different and different ideas of polarizing it. But what's the most important is that from those separate two graphs, I can calculate them on separate machines, and what I'm returning is actually a subset, because if I'm talking about the shortest path, I want to turn all the edges. I will just return this one, this edge, and in this case, nothing. So I am processing it on the machines that have the data, and then returning this data and comparing it to one machine. This is basically like MapReduce. Yeah, so the most efficient way of processing data. Next. An example, because you shouldn't believe my words, so let's have some numbers. Basically, if you want to have a huge data set, I think Berkeley has a division in a web page that basically has huge dumps of social media graphs. They are anonymized, so you actually won't find yourself, but yeah, you have dumps of like 60 gigabytes and so on and so on. So they took Twitter from 2009 with those numbers, billions and millions, yeah, so quite big. And they done this. Basically took the cheapest instances and put the computation engine of Python on it. And they took six very big, the biggest, nodes of Scalandra. So what they actually done is process all this data and here and store it here. Why was it awesome? Oh, something up. This is the operations. Node creating, recommendations, and so on. So basically the early operations of that Twitter actually has. This is the time how long they run the experiment. This is the number of transactions per second that they actually had. But there is one number I am not showing actually. The price that they paid per hour for doing it. It was $11. It was quite cheap, I would say. Why? Because those very small instances of Amazon are quite cheap and reliable because you have 40 of them. Okay, Neo4j. Why actually Neo? Because Neo is on a site called DB Engines, a site ranking all databases. It's usually on 20th or 21st position. It's the most popular graph database there is. It has drivers for almost anything. Cypher, which is the query language, is now basically became the standard for asking graph questions. And there is a free version. Okay, the code. This is my problem. This is Qt. Qt actually is a parsing engine. And what this represents is all the ingredients. Okay, there are actually 3,000 ingredients. They have more than 3,000 edges. And because this is a tree connected, they go up to ninth level of deep. Why am I talking about it? Because I am scraping websites and extracting recipes. I am doing it automatically, so I will have some mistakes. And I was wondering if I have some mistakes. So I wanted to ask a question my data. I wanted to know if I have recipes that have fish and sweet drinks like a Coca-Cola and so on in text. Because if they have, I think I may have a problem. So what I that is not good. Wait, it's gonna have to change display. Do you have any ideas? Can you change the resolution? Okay.
Maybe
Okay. I'll do it this way.
Yeah.
Okay. With no animations, but sorry. Okay. What I've done here is basically the first is match. Match is saying, look out, I will say some path that you should then find, match the path. Next, basically, Cypher, think of it as something that became after a really strange love between SQL and SQL. It's strange, but it's good. next, those round things, basically if you put anything in it, Cypher will say that it is a node. It's simple. This is the name of the node, and this is the label. Basically a type for the node. Next, and the same of course for the ingredient. Next, I am saying how they are connected. This arrow indicates a relation. This indicates the type of the relation. So I said that I want to have recipes and all the of their ingredients. Next, what I'm looking for is this end, so this ingredient. I want you to look through all of its relations. Basically, this is saying like, well, go and find up to 9th level deep. Go through the relations of type from and specification until you find the node of type ingredient that will have a property name with values with rings. And of course, the same for fish. Then I return both of them, the recipes and the ingredients, and as it turned out, I should put a limit on it because my data is not as clean as I like to. Because, and this is actually showing the most functions of Cypher. And what is awesome about it? You are not thinking about where this data is. You are actually giving paths, giving some kind of relation that asking questions. Do you know if a situation happens? You are not saying go from table this and this and this. You are not giving the root. The database should find the root. So yeah, this is why Cypher is actually the standard of asking graph questions. And the last one, without animation. When to use them, when not to use graph databases. And this is the most important slide, especially this part. When to use, when you have hierarchical structures, hierarchical data, then those databases really shine and they are really good. When there's a saying that you should use them when your relations are more important than your data. So if you are storing images or any blob files and you want to query them, no, they are not. This is not the right use case. Next, to finding search patterns in data. So basically, getting the hang of how your data actually looks like, and for better visualizing of it. Next, the most important, when not to use. For systems that manipulate heavy data, basically, if you are writing blobs and so on, don't use them. This data, because how is it stored, this data goes into RAM. If you are swapping between disks, it will go bad. Next, if you have big data, don't go with ACID transactions. Most of those databases, they have ACID transactions, but for big data sets, no way. And the last and the most important, don't use them as a replacement for relational databases because you will fail. They are not a general purpose database as relational databases are. And that's all. Any questions?
Would I use those databases aside from relational databases?
Yes, I am actually doing it because in Qgit, I am all the graph structure for the ingredients is stored in a relational database because storing and representing it in a relational doesn't make any sense. Basically, for me, it's the question that you can have multiple data stores. And as long as one data store is the point of truth for one data set, it would be okay, because basically they don't interfere with each other. So yeah, it's actually a good idea to do it.
One question for me. How do you make sure that you both answer?
The question was, how do I make sure that data is in sync? This was partially answered by what I said, that
if one database is the point of truth for one dataset, you don't have to actually make sure that they are same. Because if you change one set of something in one database, the other is looking at a bit older data, but it's actually quite okay. You have those milliseconds to sync them. But because the second database isn't right into this dataset, you will have some inconsistency, but we are living in the age of the web, so someone will hit F5 and the page that actually loads is auto-sync with actually what you have in the database. So no one cares about those milliseconds of inconsistency as long as you are not working in a bank. Anyone?
More questions? Okay.
So thank you, Stan, again.